we'll get right to it. And that is, we focus here on the most important aspect is how to manage our success. We just have to trust that those who are viewing the videos are truly having success. And so how to manage it is all important. And we say full stop in the wow is how to manage it. And we'll make, you know, comments and clarifications on this. And I'm saying this because I'm having a lot of success, quote unquote. All this is in quotes. These are words, of course. Words seem to be inherently not it, okay, but pragmatically we use them, which is fine, because we're talking here about managing our success. Now, when you have the insight, when the formless aspect of spirit, which we all are, we're all formless freedom, so it has no definition at all, and yet we still, we still are, everything is, and we're all creative, but we're formless without any definition. So when that undefinableness, which is what we are, is coming aware and accepting that that's what we are, we're undefinable isness, we're not a self. How do we manage that realization, like our acceptance? And what we do throughout history, the advice is really, I'm seeing it's all the same throughout history, and we're just using the term wow. I'm coming across so many great teachers, and they're saying the exact same thing, but it's a different label or something. But we're just saying wow. It's very appropriate. It's not like some cheap imitation advice. No, it's solid gold advice, 24 karat gold advice. Wow, full stop in the wow. You just say wow. You don't formulate a reaction from some self, because the whole realization is that there is no self, actually. And so as soon as we start formulating a reaction, we're trying to say, well, there is a self who's having this reaction. But when we just say, wow, it's hard to formulate back to a self from this wow, meaning something definable, that what we are is, when we say self in quotes, we mean we believe that we have a definable self. We don't. Now, the big self in capital letters is just a term to differentiate and just say, you know, you are the undefinable, perfectly free isness, formless, you know, formlessness. That's the capital self. It's just one. You know, there aren't these little selves. There are no selves, plural. There's only the one self, which is formless from the standpoint of words. There are aspects. God creates aspects of perfect freedom, but they're all equally undefinable. They're all equally free. So you can't differentiate them at the level of words at all, or concepts. It's not possible. So words are awkward, okay? This is why we go past words to the wow reaction. It's the right way to do it. And whether you label it wow or aha or suchness, are you? This is the technique that's been used throughout history. This is what I'm finding out. And the Holy Spirit just suggested this to me and said, you know, this is, gradually I just came to realize this is how you have to do it. And it's true. So this morning I went through this most intense workout. The formless freedom that I am went through this very intense workout. Very, very, very intense. And I just, you know, wowed it. And I can tell you this, the only way you're ever going to get through this sort of level of intensity of workout is to be very skillful in wowing whatever arises. Very dedicated. It's not so much a skill, but a determination and a familiarity. It's like saying that running upstairs is a skill. There's not so much skill involved. There's determination involved. So where the rubber meets the road is, are you going to try to be skillful, or are you going to go with your determination? Trust your determination. I would say, what we say here is trust your determination. Trust it. And so I'm here to be an advocate for trusting your determination. in recognizing there is no self. So I had this, went through this very intense, when I was woke up this morning, I asked for some help, and wow, it came in terms of being determined to look at this. And it's building on all the success I've had previously. And last night I went on Facebook, I went through a lot of these pictures with, you know, their little captions or little quotes or little description or some. This is kind of what Facebook, there's a whole spiritual, big amorphous spiritual community out there that this is what they do. And friending is just a way of sharing this with you. And you know, I put up a lot of pictures yesterday on my timeline to share with others. There's not a lot of people are hip to that, what I'm sharing yet. But I understand there's this community. You're not like personal friends. It's just, hey, maybe you'd like my sharing here. And I'd say, yeah, I found a couple of friends that are very good at sharing, actually. I kind of check out to see, look at their timeline, see what have they been sharing. And there are some who are very, very good at this. And so I friend them. And so I have on my timeline all these pictures. Well, there's this one website, Nyingma Masters, and they had this picture of a statue of Padmasambhava, Guru Rinpoche, a real Dharma king, powerful Dharma king. And I was looking at it, and he's got the eyes seem to be almost bulging out or something, but they're not really bulging. And I was able to get past, I was able to go into the Dharmakaya body, I believe, the bliss, even maybe past the bliss body to the Dharmakaya body, see it. It was very powerful. And what he said was, you have to, in practice, you have to blend the words with your beingness. You have to mix it in. He said, they all say the same thing. All these Dharma kings are saying the same thing. And it's the same thing as we're saying here. As a Dharma prince, I'm echoing what they're saying and practicing what they're saying. It's determination. When you're going to run like there's this race, the Empire State Building, stairs to the top or something, and you run the stairs, I think there's like how many hundred flights of stairs? Several hundred. You can, and there's a race to the top, and I think, wow. So when you're facing that, is it skill? So there's a group of people, we call them devotees, who are talking, and they're at the bottom floor of this Empire State Building, and they're sharing this, talking about, discussing, and they're talking about, what's my strategy? What's my skill? What kind of skill can I use? And they're primarily looking at the path from a standpoint of skill. This actually presumes there's a self on the path, a definable self on the path. There isn't. And then there's another group that they're quiet. What are they doing? They're summoning their will and determination. And they realize this is just a gut test, you know. This is just sheer determination. And there's a little bit of strategy. But overthinking that, you find you lose your determination and will because you're fearful now. And you're thinking, okay, is there some special technique? And no, there's no special, you know, technique that's going to mean that you don't have to have the guts and the determination and courage. You're going to have that totally, totally. But what our mistake that we make when we go into too much devoteeness, now, a little bit of devoteeness is fine, but that cannot supersede the determination. So you might say we're super determined and a little bit of devoted, a little bit devotee. So it's when this balance gets out of whack that it's out of whack in the world right now. We've lost this sense of determination. And now it's all just chit-chat, you know, share this, okay. Skill, okay, I'm getting the skill. As soon as I get the skill, I'll do it. You know what? They never do it. I say, well, I haven't quite got the skill yet. So the Holy Spirit says, you want me to run up the stairs? I said, really? Yeah. Wow. And then this activates my determination, because the only way I'm going to do this is I got to be super determined. I got to pay the price here. This is going to really gas me, you know? Wow. And then you get ready to pay the price and bring your spirit to it. Be very determined. So I did that this morning. And I said, okay, I know that I'm ready to wow whatever arises, and I'm just going to keep wowing it. And it was, you know, very intense. However, when you bring your determination to wow what arises, then guess what? It's easy. It's easy. It's not nearly as difficult as you thought when you were just struggling with skill. You know, how do I skillfully do this? How can I appear that it's not a problem for myself, that there's no self? Right? This is what we're doing. How can I show everyone that the fact that there's no self is not a problem for myself at all? And that's where devotees are stuck at. Now you look at Guru Rinpoche, he's kind of scary. Just like Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj used to be kind of scary. He's ferocious. He seems ferocious. But I looked at him yet last night, and I didn't see any ferocity at all. In fact, I didn't see anything there at all except formless spirit. It's when we try to superimpose a self upon Guru Rinpoche that it seems to be ferocious, but there's no self there. It's just the light, the clear light is there. Very powerful. So I spent all night until 2 o'clock in the morning posting pictures of on Facebook of Anandamaya, Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, Ram Maharshi, Longchenpa, Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro, Jesus Christ, and looking at these other pictures that other people are posting from Krishnamurti, Nisargadatta Maharaj, Padmasambhava, you know, for hours and hours and hours and hours and hours. I'm just intensely engage with this. It's a very helpful practice, actually. You can take it two different ways. These pictures, you could either be too much devoteeness or get your determination in the ascendancy. Okay. You can overthink it, or you can decide to be determined and wow it. So, you know, is it helpful or is it not? It depends what you bring to it. If you're just trying to be a skillful devotee, then you're just spinning your wheels. Okay? And you're it's just, that's not it. But if you decide to be a super determined wowist, then I looked at Padmasambhava. Finally, that's the first time I ever really looked at him. I experienced him. I experienced what is there. There's no self there. There's no self there. There's just the light is there. The formless light. Non-defined formless light. So I experienced that. And I said, wow. So it's determination. I brought some determination to it. And so I experienced it. And I mixed, I blended it, so to speak, in with whatever words and concepts there are. But my determination and the wow, those go hand in hand. Because certainly when you reach the top through your determination, what are you going to feel? Wow, I did it. I can't believe I did it. It's like, it's incredible. How did I do that? Wow. So your success is there when you bring your determination really bring your determination, you're going to have tremendous success. And then you're going to be shocked. Like, wow. I didn't know if it was possible, if I could do this. So this is the crux of the whole situation for everyone, is managing their success, bringing the determination. But when you bring the determination, you're going to have success. So there's the wow. You have to manage it. It's the same, no matter who, what kind of devotee, what kind of background, it's all the same. You have to bring your determination. And when you do that, you will succeed beyond your expectations, and then you'll have this wow. You will succeed beyond your expectations. Always. What's wrong with the devotees, and they always stay within their expectations. They keep focusing on skill. I got to find a real skillful way to do this. What they mean is, I got to find some way to succeed within my expectations. And of course, their expectations is that there's someone that's succeeding. And that's delusion. There's a self that's succeeding. So that never gets anywhere. That's just spinning your wheels. You have to succeed beyond your expectations. Expectations of what the quote-unquote self can do. And there is no self. Never has been. Not even a trace. And these are insights that I had this morning. I had many, many insights. And that's not as important as managing success. So what happens, the question in your mind is, what happens after you have these super mega insights, which I did, and clarifications and accepted, wow, that what's wrong, you know, Rama Maharshi's talking about, wow, I see it, Padmasambhava, I see it, Longchenpa, I see it, wow. You know, Buddha and delusion are the same intrinsic spaciousness, however you want to say it. But these insights arose, all these insights rose up, and I just wowed this, wow, I see that, wow, okay, wow, that, okay, yeah, many, 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 many. So the question is, what do you do after that? See, this is really the question that people are asking. What do you do when you exceed your expectations? Now, what's important to recognize is you will exceed them by a little bit, not a lot. So you might be saying, oh, you must have, you're having these great realizations, you must be exceeding your expectations unbelievably. No. Because I've already done so much work and had, you know, glimpses that were similar. So I just went a little further, you know, a little further or so. So it's just the same as same old, same old. You go beyond your expectations by a little bit, and then you just wow it. You just full stop in the wow and let it calm down. It's the same. So the first step on the path is the same as the last step, you might say. You exceed your expectations by a little bit. You're very determined, and you have a breakthrough. You break through the barrier of your expectations, and then you just wow it, wow. You just stay in stride, like you do an intense workout, and you wow, I made it to the top. What do? Well, you just kind of walk around and catch your breath, like always. If you're good enough to run to the top of the Empire State Building, when you get to the top, what do? You say, wow, I made it. Are you like dead? No. Because you've been working out, gradually increasing your capacity for a long time. And so this time you just have a little more determination, you're in shape, and you really push it, and you get to the top. It's like, you're tired, like, wow, but yeah, it's not like overwhelming. It's not overwhelming. So all these insights arose. It wasn't overwhelming. I'm not overwhelmed at all. There's a wow. Like I had a really intense workout. So if you're like a fitness trainer or something, it's very helpful. You can use this paradigm. It applies very closely, actually, is that the the end of the workout, you did more than you thought you could do. You say, wow, okay, I'm a little stronger than I thought I was. You know, I'm because you bring your determination to it. Now, when you don't bring your determination, you feel weak, right? But when you really summon your will and determination, then you're able to do this, and you say, wow. But make sure you're not trying to push further by, you know, using stimulants. Because then you'll push too far, and the wow will be too strong, and you think, oh, my determination's a scary thing. So you sabotage yourself. You don't want to exceed your expectations too much, because then the backlash will come. So I exceeded my expectations a little bit. A little bit, yeah. But it would seem profound to someone else if they haven't been practicing every single day. They'd say, oh, that's unbelievable. You know, no, if not for me, I practice every single day, 24/7. So I'm always going past my expectations. This is all I've done my whole life. This is basically all I've ever done, is keep pushing through, use determination to push through the expectations. So for me, it was just like a really intense workout, and yeah, I'm tired, but it's great. Used to it. And of course, you'll feel tired after workout. And you'll feel the burn. You feel the burn, right? When you work out, you feel this burn, and you realize, you know, I'm getting it done here. And so, how do you summon the will, etc.? Well, you know, it's once you have the workout, you're recovering from it, and now you have to summon the will to keep going. Well, this is where the artfulness of it comes in. And your own, the genius of the Holy Spirit. You have to have the Holy Spirit helping you out, because it starts rebuilding your determination and will, so that you can then go past your expectations again. But don't go for a coffee or you know, energy drink to do this. Trust the Holy Spirit to do it. You have to have trust in the Holy Spirit. A caffeinated society is a society that is spinning its wheels, actually. And we'll end up just as devoteeness, and then creating this wall that say our expectations, this is what our expectations are, and we can go no further. And what this world is doing is it's making it easy to be insane here. This is what the future of this world is. It's a very easy place to be insane. Hope and change. Very easy place to be insane. And there are many of us who say, no. We don't want complacency like that. We want to push past the wall of our expectations. So there's this definite separation here in the world taking place between those who want a world that's it's very easy to be insane, make it super easy for you, and those who want a world that doesn't make it easy for you to be insane, not at all. That's inviting us to push past our expectations. Challenging us, inviting us, you can do it, you know, attracting us to that. So this is the real, I say all politics are spiritual politics. This is the real divide that's taking place right now. It's a very intense divide. A lot of people in the world, they just want complacency, and they want to try and make the most of it and try to be happy within this, you know, prison of expectations, that there's a self, a definable self. And this is insanity. So they want to have a comfortable, easy insanity, not realizing that insanity is constantly compounding itself. This is the insidious snake in the mix. And so for a while it may seem that it's nice and easy and simple, you know, and comfortable complacency is great. But at some point, suddenly we start to realize there's some horrible, poisonous snake in the room. You know, we're going to get bit, and we start getting bit, and it becomes hideous, because insanity always compounds itself. That's its attempt to get rid of truth. Of course, so it doesn't work out the way that the hope and change people tell you it works out. Not at all. In fact, it's terrible. And this is what the wise ones are always say. Never trust in those who are peddling complacency. And never trust in the hope and change people. They can make it seem slick at the beginning, okay, and attractive, but it always becomes terrible. The compoundment of insanity becomes unbearable at some point. Unbearable. Guaranteed. This is for sure. This is what happens. So it doesn't matter how slick the presentation is of the Hope and Change people. You just ignore it. You say, absolutely, I'm not having anything to do with that. I'm not even struggling against it. I am simply on the path. I'm wowing. I trust in the Holy Spirit. I trust the path. I trust in the Holy Spirit. I trust in the Dharma Kings. I trust the Holy Spirit will build up my determination and will just for my attention that it's a genius at this. I don't need energy drinks to get my energy and will. The Holy Spirit will summon it within me. It will attract me to it. Trust in this. Yesterday I was super, super tired driving. And I had to worked about 11 and a half hours yesterday. Very intense. And I said, oh boy, and I got real sleepy. I said, I'm ready to pass out here. I said, I got to go for the energy drink. I had an emergency one in case, you know. But I said, if I do that, I am going to miss out on some really profound insight. I know I am. I just know I am because I can feel it coming. But I said, but I'm in this bind, you know. What do I do? Well, I prayed to Jamyan Khyentse Chokyi Lodro, the action Dharma King that seems to be most easy to relate with. Because he's just been here recently, and the way he was, very approachable. You know, you feel it. So I prayed to him. I said, Jamyan, you know, if I drink that energy drink, I'm going to miss out on what you have to share with me. And you know that. You know it. I know it, you know it, so we'll do whatever you got to do, but don't let me drink that energy drink. Well, I made it through. I made it through. Didn't drink it, and I ended up now having this tremendous practice session this morning. A lot of great work last night, and pushed it through where there's no way in the world I could have done that. If I had drinking the energy drink, no way in the world. You really have to have this pure intent, and in control of the situation. You have to feel you're in control. As you go through this wow, you have to feel that you can stop it at any moment if you really want to. If you're on energy drink and you haven't slept last in the night because you're too hyped up, and you don't feel entirely in control, you don't. And so you'll panic, you'll back away, So I know this, from long experience, I guarantee this, that the real depth insights you can't get to if you have the habit of always, you know, turning to coffee and caffeine. You won't be able to get to them. You'll be stuck in skillful, considering how do I do this skillfully, instead of just sheer determination and faith and trust and wow, and you're wowing. So I'm just going to wow whatever rises. I'm just going to wow it. That's it. No other reaction. Just sheer determination like this. But also the ability to instantly stop if you want to. You have to have that because you're not sure what's going to arise. You're not. We're not sure what's going to arise. So you have to have those breaks, but you can't be slamming the brakes too hard either. So you have to be a very good driver, so to speak. Very alert driver. Pure, clear determination. Not artificial determination. Not drugs. Cannot do it through drugs. You cannot. Nobody can. Nobody can. Samsara and nirvana are the same in intrinsic spaciousness. Now, so Jamyang helped me out somehow. He's done that a number of times already, and I kept saying, I said, Jamyang, I'm losing it, you know, I'm losing my determination. Help me. And I suddenly received a jolt, like of determination, super positive determination. Quite a few times I had to do that. I said, I'm slipping, I'm not making it. I need help. Give me some determination, and He did. And it's sort of like, whoa, woke me up, and I felt this positivity like that, and I was able to keep driving that way. I trusted in him. I trusted him. I said, I know I can trust in you. I just don't know how, what you're going to do. And it turned out that he kept me going, so I didn't fall, just collapse. And then I could then, st I didn't even have to take a nap when I got home. I just went to Facebook. I started posting and reading all and going through all this and staying engaged. Then had interesting dreams, woke up and began working on this and had this tremendously intense workout. Super, super mega workout. And now I'm calm, okay. Everything went exactly the way I wanted it to go. Didn't feel out of control in any regard the whole way. Smooth driving. Yeah, fast, driving a super fast muscle car. The more I'm looking now, I'm seeing so many muscle cars on the road now. It's amazing. It really is. So many. I didn't realize it, but some of them are kind of unobtrusive. A lot of Mustangs, GT Mustangs. Not so many Shelbys, but GT Mustangs. A lot of Chargers. A lot. Course, Teslas are the ultimate muscle car, 0 to 60. Right. There's a ton of them, too, here. There's like Speed City here. But anyway, it's like driving a muscle car. And you're driving like a Ferrari. You're driving a Ferrari. And you drive it smooth. You go through town. You're cruising through town. There's a section here you need to go fast. You accelerate through that. Then you brake and then you slow down. And you got the horsepower. You don't have to use all of it. But it's there. And you use it. Sometimes you use it. There's a place you need to speed past. And then you slow down. But you're always in control. You're not panicking. You don't have too much adrenaline. The wow is really not. It's not going into the reptilian mind of adrenaline, fight or flight. You're not doing that. You're neither advancing nor retreating. You're staying in the wow mode. So you stay out of the reptilian mind. The world is enmeshed in the reptilian mind, which is what is it, the hind brain, or there's some part of the core of the brain of the stem or something. It's fight or flight, food, sex, survival, fight or flight. That's the reptilian mind, we call it. And the entertainment, the news, the culture, pop modern culture is all about the reptilian mind. It just feeds it and feeds it and feeds it and feeds it and feeds it. So that's why you have to boycott it. If you really want to get these the realization, you have to stay away from that stuff. You have to boycott it. Now I'm indulgent. I mean people post links and I okay them, but seriously, Hollywood movies, boycott it. Boycott it. Boycott. There's nothing good in it. It's all reptilian. I don't care what spiritualized theme is presented, it's all appealing to the reptilian mind, actually. It's spiritualizing concepts. It's staying within the prison of our expectations. Can't get there that way. Cannot. Cannot. Longchenpa knows this. Thank God for Longchenpa. Longchenpa's in the house. I feel so assured. Just reminding myself, he's got our backs. He's in the house. What a blessed assurance that is. Reading some of his quotes last night, reading, I just, oh wow, it's so much better than the run-of-the-mill Tibetan Buddhism you get. It's very nice. But Longchenpa, oh, you're up there breathing the rarefied air. And the oxygen content is so much greater. It's like, oh wow, I'm really being oxygenated, spiritually oxygenated. Oh, it's lovely. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I thank all the gurus and everyone for sure, because they're giving us some spiritual oxygen. But you get to Longchenpa and you realize that that's even the oxygen's even richer, a lot richer. And you say, I like this. I feel immediately confident. I sort of been kind of shying away from him a little bit because he brings this super confidence. And it's hard to express this in the world, isn't it? So Jam Yang is a little step down from that super confidence. We kind of look at him and say, okay, he handled his business in the world in a very humble way and there's no problem. But you look at Longchenpa and you think, oh my gosh, I'm going to be just super confident, just radiant, you know, Padmasambhava-like, you know. is the reptilian world, which is what this world is. We're the world, 99.99% of the world is enmeshed in the cage of reptilian mind expectations, that there's some self, a definable self. They're enmeshed in that, and they're working pell-mell, all out, to make this world a place where it's comfortable to be insane, where everyone's encouraged to be insane. This is what the world is all about right now. All about this. Even all those devotees, they may not understand it, but they're working for that too. Unless they tip the scale towards more determination. Okay, so there's a lot of devotees right now. They're still on the fence, but guess what? They're not on the fence. Actually, they think they're on the fence. They're not. They're actually working to make the world comfortable for insanity. So you have to be more determined than you are devotee. So I don't characterize myself as a devotee. I characterize myself as someone who's desperately determined. That's all. Longchenpa says, "Well, that means you're a Dharma prince." I said, "Well, okay, if you say so, I'll use that term, fine. But I see myself as desperately determined." So you can see yourself that way too. Don't try to be a super devotee. Be desperately determined. Now, I thought I might have gotten sort of drifted away from Longchenpa, but I hadn't really, because I'd just been working out like crazy, like what he wants me to do. And he was just, you know, standing back and letting me go for it. And then now I come back and he says, "Hey, you're in a lot better shape, aren't you?" And I say, "Yeah, I am." He says, "Well, take a look at this." You know, I looked at it. I said, "Wow. Wow." So if we're not working out or recovering, we're just spinning our wheels. We should either be working out or recovering right now. That's it. Working out or recovering. That seems like very disciplined. Yeah. It's very disciplined. It's very determined. Now we don't sit around blah, 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 blah. It's never about the words here. Okay, don't think it's about the words here. It's never about the words. Of course we're using words because we have a severe continuity problem. But we're only using the words because we have a severe continuity problem, not because the words actually mean anything or indicate anything. But pragmatically, we get some echo from them. They can give a faint sort of echoishness, sort of, which can be helpful, right? But it's never about the words here. Never. Never. It's about the practicing. It's about managing our success. It's always about managing our success because we summon, through the Holy Spirit, enables us to summon our determination. The Dharma Kings encourage us in that too. The Holy Spirit uses the Dharma Kings to summon our determination. Then we push past our expectations, and then we wow this. Wow, I went beyond my expectations. I didn't know I could do this. I thought that was it. No. We wow it, and then, so then we're in recovery phase. So we work out, then we go into recovery phase. We manage our success, and then we summon up more determination and then push past our expectations again. This is all we do. That's it. It's never about the words. It's never about just the skillful means at all. So don't get lost in the words at all. In fact, you don't need very many words at all. Just a sentence, just a word, trust it. That's it. That's all I need to hear. I heard Ramana says, trust it. I said, that's it. Thank you. That's it. I don't need anything more. Just trust it. These teachers who use very few words, I find, are very helpful now. We needed to get up to speed in the West because we were way, way too much into devoteeness and wordiness and selfness and sophisticated selfness. And so A Course in Miracles helped us with that. A Course in Miracles was very wordy because we needed that. We were obsessed with words, academically obsessed. And Jesus said the purpose of A Course in Miracles is to make itself obsolete. He says, and he always told me, go beyond the words. Go beyond the course. Go, 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 go. You can make it. You can make it. You don't need the course. You know, you can make it. You're using the course to make it obsolete for you. Go, 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 go. I said, what do you mean, Jesus? Don't you want me to be your devotee? No, 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 no. Go, 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 go. So then you become then you only need a few words, like a sentence or a paragraph. That's it. Journey Beyond Words is much more succinct. So I said, oh, that's better. I like that now. And now these great Dharma kings, like, well, that's redundant, but Dharma kings, Ramaharshi, I mean, the Sagara Maharaj, you know, I haven't said that he's a Dharma king at this point, but he's way up there. You know, he's way up there. Anandamayi Ma, Dharma king for sure. Longchenpa, Dharma king for sure. Okay. Jesus Christ, Dharma king for sure. Jamyang Kensi Chogyi Lodro, I feel he's a Dharma king for sure. These teachers could just use a word, one word, or just a phrase. Trust it. Ramana's great at this, you know, really great. Sagara Maharaj is really good at it. Ramana seems to be just about the best at this, you know. It's just, and you think, well, where's the rest of the words? I need words, because I'm a definable self. No, we're not a definable self. So we use words, give the impression that there's a definable self. And less words give the impression there isn't. And of course, Ramana was the expert at silence. And he said, silence says everything, which is what? There is no definable self at all. And silence constantly says this. So he says it's the best teaching, it's the highest teaching. But very few are ready for that. So in the West, our background, etc., we were really, really badly stuck. Very badly stuck and going in a very bad direction. This is why A Course in Miracles, Jesus gave us A Course in Miracles here in the West. A lot of the Eastern, they're not paying any attention to that because they're focused on the more, you know, more just simpler. They have faith, a lot of faith. They're not so stuck in words, at least some of them. Some of them. They still are stuck in words, but the tradition is less words is better. So in the West, we were going towards more words are better. We were in a very bad place, actually. Terrible. So Jesus came and rescued us from that place. He absolutely did. It wasn't Ramana that rescued us. It was Jesus Christ that rescued the West. Okay. He came in there with this, you know, massive amount of words, but used them in such a way. It was a very difficult enterprise that he did. Very difficult. Quite astonishing. Very humbling, you know. I mean, the degree of difficulty and commitment is just astonishing what Jesus did. But he didn't mean for us to get stuck in it. I saw a video with Ken, I think it was Ken Wapniak, is that how you say it? Kenneth Wapniak. And he's giving this talk about, you know, non-duality. Don't get stuck in non-duality or something. But actually, it's a very good talk. The title's kind of misleading. I like Ken Wapniak. I mean, I don't have a problem. I like him, what he says. He understands the course. He presents it pretty well. But there's all these students, looking at him. He's like a professor. He's up at a lectern, like in a room, like exactly like you would do in a university. And they're all taking notes, earnestly taking notes. Like, this is a class. I need to get an A in the class. And I'm saying, what are they doing? And the course came out of an academic setting. Ken was, I think, an academic, and certainly Helen and William, Bill Tedford were academics, and the whole thing developed within the high academic setting of the United States. And William Bill Tedford was in that, and he actually wrote about that in off of a book or something. I read a lot about that from him. It was amazing, his journey, and just saying, wow, this is crazy. I mean, do I really want this? But he was very good at it. I was certainly on within all of that growing up, but I rejected it. And so I was sort of a black sheep. You know, people say, oh, you know, you just, you know, you're not going to amount to anything. But we were, you know, very much in high academia. Both my parents were teachers. My dad was a superintendent of schools. You know, he went to Stanford for his PhD, which eventually he got so sick of Stanford, he gave him the boot. You know, he says, man, you guys are, you know, over academicized, too much. And he said, hey, there's got to be a better way than this. So I very much respected that. And he went towards, you know, less words. He was still pretty caught up in words. He made him poetic. Poetic, you know, and you know, Sri Aurobindo and stuff. But I mean, that's still, you know, caught up in words. It's still believing there's a definable self. So, but he got into Ram Maharshi, absolutely. So he was really making progress along the path. But I know about academia. I mean, because we were in it back then in the late 50s, the 60s, you know, the set. And my God, it's deadly. It's deadly. So, no notes. You know, notes are deadly. Don't take notes. It's the worst thing ever. Don't take notes. What is this? A class, a university class? It's the opposite of that. Flunk out. You're supposed to flunk out of the self. You're supposed to fail to realize a self. There is no self to realize. There never has been. There's no dreamer of the dream, actually, at all. There's no dream. There's no existence, actually, at all. Existence has never existed. There's no one to whom it could exist for, at all. And so they're taking notes. Okay, they want the self to know that there is no self. You know, they say, okay, note to the self, there is no self. That's not going to work. That's devotee-ness, spinning your wheels. And this is what Jesus, I had many, many meetings with Jesus, and he implored me and not to get caught up in that. He says, you must not get caught up in that. You're going to make it, okay? And I'm telling you, just forget about all that stuff. Don't be part of it. He says, they will try to institutionalize it, academicize it, all this. He says, I already know that. For you, you're not going to do that. Okay, you're going to make it. So don't get caught up in all the groups. And what Ken was saying was basically the same thing, and yet he was doing it in a context which was sort of feeding the beast. So, you know, they're still a little nervous about it all, you know. Helen, Bill, Ken, they're still nervous about it. They're kind of a little bit self-conscious about it. So I've never been welcome in the Course in Miracles community at all. It's quite astonishing. No matter what I do, I'm persona non grata. I'm never made welcome. I'm kind of like, wow, folks, I've been at it 40 years almost, intensely, super, 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 all out 24/7 for almost 40 years, and I'm not. You don't want to listen to a word I say, or you don't want to share, or say hello, or nothing. It's like, wow, Okay. But Longchenpa says hello to me. He says, come on up here and breathe this oxygen. I said, okay. And Jesus didn't want me to be part of it. He said, no. That's not for you. Well, it's not designed to, it's for teachers of God, not for some religion or institutionalize it, which is what Ken was saying. He was saying, but everybody's there, all these academics taking notes. A lot of housewives, a lot of wealthy women who don't work, they go on, they become professional devotees. This is what they do. And they think this is a way to spend their time, and they think that this is, you know, make them happy. And so most spirituality in the world now is supported by wealthy women, actually. They're the backbone of this devotee-ness spiritual in the world. They absolutely are. Basically, it's always been this way throughout history in a lot of ways. Even though the Catholic Church is supported by women, wealthy women. Absolutely it is. They tell the man, I mean, most times they have the checkbook, and they write the checks to the church. They say, tell the man, we won't, you know, let's give $500 this month. And, it's a lot. No, we got to do this. Okay, don't worry, I'm budgeting everything. They want to make sure that they keep supporting devotee-ness, being a disciple. Mean stay within the realm of their expectations. They want to make sure that everything supports that wall of expectations remaining for them. This is really what disciples, devotees are doing. They have their idol, they have their guru, and they can't say, and then they create a religion of expectations around that, all supporting the notion that there's some self that existence is happening to. There's no self that existence is happening to, and therefore there isn't any existence at all. Never has been. But this is the fear. Continuity fear causes us to try and institutionalize these expectations around a centralized, you know, figure like Jesus. And Jesus said, hey, you've made a lot of bitter idols out of me, I'm telling you. And you've used me to imprison yourself. He said, that's not what I want at all. But he said, I understand you're honoring time, but it's really, it's more than that. Your continuity fear is what it is. And he did say that. He said, yeah, it's really continuity fear. That's your real fear. He said, I assure you, the Holy Spirit will not push you beyond what you're capable, not push you into panic. The ego will try to push you into panic spiritually by using drugs and various stuff, rituals and things. That's a bad thing to do. Because then you lose your trust. The whole thing here is to trust it. Trust Ram Maharshi, for instance. He says, trust it. Trust the Holy Spirit. He's basically saying, trust the grace of God. Don't trust in ritual. Trust the grace of God. Rituals only works if you have a tremendous support system in place. Tibetans use it. They put up a tremendous support system, so they could force the issue somewhat through rituals and visualizations and all that. But that requires tremendous trust, not just in your guru, but in a whole lineage and support system of gurus that you can call upon. So many spiritual helpers, and you trust all of them. Not only you trust them, but all your friends and colleagues and family and everybody trusts them. Only under those circumstances is the Vajrayana Buddhism, is it successful. But Padmasambhava, they understood that in Tibet there's the opportunity to do this, because of its isolation and the situation there and such. They saw that it could work, but it doesn't transplant very well at all, actually. This is what they're discovering, the Tibetan Buddhists are discovering. It doesn't really transplant well at all. And so they're saying, whoa, you know, wow, what's going on? Well, don't worry. You're not the only game in town. Okay. Longchenpa's in the house. And he's working with me. He's working with me, along with Jesus Christ and all the Dharma kings are working with me and working with devotees. Well, no, determined, courageous, determined, fearless, desperados all over the world. Yeah, we're desperados. That is, we're spiritual desperados for sure. So there's spiritual desperados. Jamyang Khyentse Chogyi Lodur, so they say, is breaking down, and now it's just going to be individual. Because Tibetan, the whole thing was cultural, you see. It was cultural. It was a cultural spirituality. That's why the Chinese went in and destroyed the culture. The reptilian mind went in to destroy that culture, tore down the culture, which they certainly did. And so that puts an end, pretty much, to Vajrayana Buddhism, actually. But don't despair, because A Course in Miracles got your back, and those who have been helped in that way, Rama Maharshi's got your back. We've all got your back. We've all got your back. Okay. So the Holy Spirit knew this would happen, and so I never went on that path at all, Vajrayana Buddhist path. No, the Holy Spirit realized it's going to, you know, these problems are coming, and you can't force it that way unless you have this massive cultural support system. Cannot. And we think these Tibetans are like some super practitioners. No, they had a massive cultural support system. I'm just as good as a practitioner as any Tibetan's ever been, actually. I just don't have the cultural support system. Just the opposite. It's completely against me. So my progress has been slower. And the Tibetans, some teachers say that, which I have to disagree with this. So it's just, I have to put it in context here. They say, if you've been practicing for a number of years and you're not feeling a lot of progress, then something's wrong. Well, this is not true. In their cultural support system, this is true. But you take away that cultural support system, and you're not going to make the rapid progress they talk about. Not at all. Not at all. So it's true in their cultural context. It's not true in, like, the cultural context of Silicon Valley. Okay. You know, at all. The progress is much slower. So it's more difficult, you might say. If you don't have a cultural support system, it becomes, you know, very difficult. And, you know, they need to recognize this better. I'm trying to help them do that, because in a way it's a put down of us. And it's sort of a way of marketing Tibetan Buddhism, Vajrayana Buddhism. It's basically say, well, how's your path? So have you feel a lot of success? And how long have you been doing it? Well, 5 years. Well, you almost there yet? No, I don't really feel. Well, there's something wrong with your path then. You know, and so come over to our path. We'll help you do it quick. This is a marketing technique. I don't know at some level they have to be aware of this. And it's dawning upon them. I mean, certainly Jamyang Khyentse Chogyi Lodur knew this very clearly, that it's breaking down. And he said, sad to say, but true. And it's going to be individuals now. And so the top Tibetan masters, they know this. But a lot of the other ones are just trying to keep, you know, the cultural momentum going, and they're trying to pull people into Vajrayana Buddhism. And by telling you, if your path hasn't worked in a couple of years, there's something wrong with your path, this is not true at all. It's absolutely not true. And we've got to be aware of this. In the West and most of the world, except Tibet, the path is much more difficult and takes a lot longer. And we do not have the cultural support system at all. And there isn't any way to generate it, actually. There really isn't. The cultural support system that Tibet had is unparalleled in the history of the world, actually. Nothing, I don't think anything even comes close to it. And there's no way in the world, the way the world is right now, that we can remotely approximate that. Not possible. And this is what Jamyang is telling us, told me, you know, it's not possible. It was a very, very, very anomaly almost, but a helpful anomaly, very helpful anomaly, but you got to realize. So if someone says, well, how long have you been working on this? Well, my whole life, very intensely, actually, 60 years, but you might say different ways, 55 years, or 48 years, you know, depending when you say I started really intensely. Say if I started at 12, it would be 48 years of super intense, all-out effort. If I started at 18, you would say it's a little less, what would that be, 38 or something. But the basic facts are my whole life. It is basically, you could say that. There's never a point in my life when I didn't feel I was intensely engaged with the truth. And so the Tibetan Buddhist might look at me and say, what kind of path are you on? It's ridiculous. What do you mean? But this is really not true, because there are many Tibetan Buddhists who like meditated in a cave for 40 years, are in their house. I mean, they spent 40 years or more just meditating, and then they achieved the rainbow body. So it took them 40 years too, their whole life. So the marketing of saying that your path isn't working for you if you're not feeling a lot of progress in a couple years, this is not true at all. They're stretching it too much. Too much. I have to say this. I have to stand up for everyone here, without losing any love for the Tibetan Buddhists at all. But they have to realize that, it stops here. The buck stops here. And as far as that rhetoric goes, I have to call you on it. It's stretching it. Here, it requires more patience, more determination. We have to go much more carefully. We have to be very disciplined, full stop in the wow. And the progress is bit by bit. It doesn't go quite as fast. It doesn't go as fast because of the lack of cultural support. In fact, basically, massive sabotage effort towards us is what we experience here. My whole life I've experienced nothing but massive sabotage toward me as far as culture in general. That's it. No cultural support. Zero. Worse than zero. Massive sabotage. So Tibetan Buddhism, they're surrounded. They grow up in the monastery. Their whole life, massive support. Everywhere they turn, everyone's supporting them. Here, everywhere we turn, everyone is into intense egoic sabotage in attempting to lure us into reptilian perspective. So, they're starting to feel this too. I mean, they're like, I could tell on their faces, these Rinpoches and stuff, that's like, you guys just don't get it, what are you doing? This is not working out the way we thought it would. And so, Don't lose your practice. Just practice. Don't worry. Listen a little bit to those who've been in the belly of the beast all this time. Maybe you'll get helpful perspective from that. I come from this different perspective, which, I mean, be ecumenical. I mean, I get help from every which way, but I find some of these approaches are so insular, they only get help from their own perspective, and they think that culturally we're going to succeed. And guess what? You're not. The Chinese put an end to that, and the world is, the reptilians are putting an end to that globally. And it's a pipe dream thinking that you can do it that way now. As Jam Yang said, it's individuals now. It's not going to be culture. So the cultural thing is going to die. He said, unfortunately, but it will. He's not the only one that said that. And it is. So those who have been doing it individually, you might want to listen to them. They might have something very, very valuable to share, right? Who have been on the front lines this whole time. I've been in the Silicon Valley the whole time, my whole life. Gone through all this hell here. Just brutal sabotage pressure here. The most brutal, you might say. So you might want to start being a little more ecumenical and listening. And hearing and wowing what you're hearing. And again, I'm super ecumenical. It's very helpful because there are different cultural traditions. When culture breaks down into reptilianism, which is what we have now, these different cultural traditions, you have to start being artful about blending them, and so that you go beyond words. You go beyond all culture, actually. Longchenpa basically went beyond the whole Tibetan Buddhist culture, actually. He said that was holding him back. So at some level, you could say it does, but it was holding him back. Well, he was, you know, the light itself. You know, we all are, but he realized that he's nothing but that. So any structure would hold him back, so to speak. So certainly there's vast helpfulness to what the traditions of Tibetan Buddhists, the determination. They sort of enculturated their determination, which was, you know, fabulous. But they're running into a wall now of the world's expectations. And you can establish, you know, a million Dharma centers if you want to, which, you know, hey, that's been done before. That's like establishing a million Christian churches everywhere. You know, we've got church everywhere. You go down to any street in suburbs, there's a church there, there's a church there, there's a church there, there's a church there. So Christianity has been unbelievably successful in establishing churches and unbelievably unsuccessful in going beyond the wall of their expectations. So you can enculturate in a smaller area that's isolated, but it takes enormous effort to keep it going. You try to do that in the entire world, and you spread yourself too thin, and you lose the juice. And this is what's happening, of course. Lose the juice. You start shallowing out, right? Termination is not there. The fire. It's not there. And you end up then just building more and more and more and more and more and more buildings. This is what happens. As Sri Srinandamaya Ma said, they all wanted to build buildings. They said, Ma, you're here. You're inspiring us to build buildings. And she goes, if that's all I'm doing, then I might as well not be here. She says, I'm not here to inspire you to build buildings. There's already too many. More than enough, she says. I'm not here to inspire you to build any buildings whatsoever. Right from the mouth of the Dharma King herself, Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma. We want to build hospitals, Ma. We want to build temples. We want all this. She's totally indifferent and detached from them. They kept bugging her and kept bugging her and kept bugging her. It's like their life's purpose. Oh, we want. So she'd say, well, you know. So she'd indulge them a little bit. But then they'd build a place for her, and then she'd go in there and she was completely detached from it. And they say, Ma, we built this for you. Aren't you attached to it? She wasn't at all. And they kind of get very upset about it. It's like, wow, what's going on here? Ma, we built a hospital in your name, a hospital in your name. Can you go there? So she'd go there and she'd smile, and yet they'd realize she's completely detached. Completely detached. So they went through this dance, you know, and it demoralized them. They said, well, can't we build a nice enough building for you? So look out for those who are building buildings. And that's their main thing. We built this building. We built this building. Oh, look, I won this wonderful, beautiful temple and this and this and this. That. They are just trying to make us comfortable with our expectations. And, of course, we put spiritual graffiti on the wall of our expectations, you know, now, you know, spiritual graffiti on the wall of our expectations. There is no self, you know. But we're just, you know, spiritual graffiti artists, basically. If we don't have the determination. Graphics are fine. They can be very helpful, actually useful, to inspire us and develop, get the summon our will and determination. But most of the world, we're just being trained to be spiritual graffiti artists. And look at history, Buddhist history. There's so many temples, stupas. I mean, look at, what's that place in Cambodia or something? You see all these old ruins. I mean, all they did was build. It seems like the monks, all they did was just build these temples out of stone. Oh, we're really spreading the Dharma. No, they're not. They're just spiritual graffiti artists. Ramaharshi, how many temples did he build? just lived in a cave. They built something for him. He said, you want me to be there? Okay. But no, they don't, they're not great builders. They can, people might wonder, can you restore this? Can you, a little bit here and there, something. But they're clearly, that's not what they're into at all. How many churches did Jesus Christ build while I was here? Answer is zero. So, we, just the presence of one enlightened being has more influence, positive influence, than building of, you know, a million churches. We should be able to recognize this by now, that this building mania we have is a defense against truth. It absolutely is. And you know, the people go to Tibetan Vajrayana Buddha and say, well, I can't, you know, I can't quite get with it. I can't, my success not coming so much, but I feel like I could really build you a nice, you know, Dharmasala, or I could build you a nice, you know, temple or whatever. So let's get some funds, and people, and everybody donates, and yeah, let's build this really beautiful temple. And so they work for like 5 years, you know, intensely putting statues and all, you know, in the temple. And, oh, they said, oh, it's a way to avoid the true sadhana. It's an avoidance technique, actually. Just wherever you are, sit wherever you are, and full stop in the wow. Be able to wow what arises in your mind. Summon your determination for an intense workout, and do that. I can't build anything. I don't have any desire to build anything. Never have. I'm very terrible at it. Because I just have no, it's not on my radar building at all. And then the builders say, well, at least you can clean up for us, then. Well, that's not really, I'm not really interested in that either. But that's what I do. I clean up for builders. You know, yeah, we made a lot of trash building this temple, you know, so it's almost got to clean it up. At least you're helping out then. You're not really good at what, you know, what needs to be done, but at least you can help out. No, by not building, I'm helping out more than anything. Helping out way more than the builders. Now, a little bit of building, if really called for, okay, can take place. But you have to be very, it's a very slippery slope. You have to put your practice first. Many of those who have realized, like Longchenpa, didn't build it, they did it in caves. You know, they didn't build anything. They're just sitting in meditation on a riverbank or in a cave or in a little hut or a hammock. I mean, they realize that that's a waste of time. My house is burning down. I got to get this done here, right now, very fast. I mean, this lifetime. So, yeah, don't fall into the syndrome. Hey, if your path hasn't helped you quick enough, our path is much quicker. And then you take that path, and you're still slow. He says, well, you know, maybe you're just not so good at it, but you could always build us a temple. Oh yeah, okay. That'll really help us help spread the Dharma. Okay. I mean, there's so many Buddhist temples in Japan. I mean, in China, is the Dharma flourishing there? I mean, so many churches in Christendom. Is Christianity actually flourishing in the Western world? No, it's dying. It's ridiculous. I can't find a single church. You know, you go to where I feel that Jesus is being considered there, being wowed there. No. Where is Jesus really being wowed? Evangelicals, well, they're overwowing it. See, they're trying to wow it. What wow arises, you're neither advancing, you're not trying, you're willing, but you don't then jump around and scream, Jesus, wow, Jesus, hey, you're right. No, wow is quiet. You're sitting quiet in the wow. You're not advancing or retreating. So they're not really practicing in the right way, actually. They're over wowing. I say, don't try to make the wow more. Don't try to make it less. Don't do anything with it. Just sit quietly. So the ones who are advocating just sitting quietly without trying to sit quietly, in other words, That's the right way. I mean, they said, just be quiet. But we say, just full stop in the wow. I think it's a really good way to put it. Full stop in the wow. You don't try to make yourself silent. You don't try to experience the wow. You just say, I'm willing to. You bring my determination and willingness. I'm going to have an intense workout here, and this is going to raise the wow for sure. So I just put up with it in the right way. So you don't become all fervently emotional. This again is spiritual graffiti artistry. So missing the mark. I mean, if Jesus came back in the world right now, what'd he say? Everybody would say, "Hey, yeah, you've done a great job. You did exactly what I told you to do." Or would he say, "You know what? You're missing the mark here. You're missing the mark here. You really missed the mark here. Let fix your mistakes." Well, he says we're making a lot of mistakes, and we need to fix them. Windy day today. Got to fix our mistakes. So you got to be willing to be admonished. And say, you know, this is, you know, love the determination, but you got to dig a little deeper here and keep your nerve. Don't lose your nerve in overdoing it. That's a way of detaching from it. Stay from your success. It's a way of trying to bury your success if you over-celebrate it, right? And just stay quietly within it. Just stay in a quiet wow. Just a quiet wow. And you're never detached from the quiet wow. Even if you're really confident, expressing super confidence, sometimes I express it. But I'm always willing to go right into the wow any instant and just be quiet. So Ken Wapniak is right. Of course, a miracle is designed to be done right within your life, ordinary life. That's what I did. It's not meant to be a group endeavor or anything. No, I never was part of any group. I did self-study all the way, 100%. But it has to be emphasized that we have to wow the course. Don't learn the course, wow it. It's not a course to be learned, it's a course to be wowed. And if you're taking notes, you're not wowing it. You're avoiding the wow. You're avoiding the wow. It's not about the words. Truth, we're already true. We're already truth. Truth already is. And there's only truth. There's nothing other than truth. We are already truth. There's nothing other than that. You have to wow that. You don't take notes on that. Okay, well, we are already the truth. Page what? Page 325, paragraph 5, sentence 16 of that. Okay, we are already the truth. Okay, let me write those notations down, the numbers here. Okay, underline, double score. Let me put a little star here. I'm going to get back to that at some point. Okay, this is missing it, missing the mark. So if I would speak to the Course in Miracles people, I'd say you're missing the mark in a lot of ways. Some ways. I mean, so are the Tibetan Buddhists in some ways. You know, someone's got to admonish. If there's no one to admonish us, do we feel comfortable with that? I don't. I want someone to admonish me. Dharma King said, you know, admonish me. Missing the mark here. Thank you. That's very helpful. So there has to be someone over everyone, except for the Dharma Kings, that can admonish and say, you're missing the mark here, because it's so easy to miss the mark here. The global culture is such that it absolutely demands, it says, if you want to be a part of the future of this planet, you have to miss the mark. There's no wiggle room at all to that. And this is what is coming now in July. Is basically, we'll get the message loud and clear. If you want to be part of the future of this planet, you absolutely have to miss the mark. No exceptions whatsoever. You must have a wall of expectations based on a belief in a definable self. You have to. This is what's coming. Some of the Tibetan Buddhists are lighting themselves on fire. Well, they should realize that there's some of us in the West that could help them actually. But they're not able to even think that way. We're not setting ourselves on fire, and our culture is just all reptilian. You know, I'm not setting myself on fire. I'm on fire spiritually, but I'm in the wow of that, you know. Oh, I am the fire, so to speak. But be the fire. Don't set yourself on fire. Be the fire. Don't set yourself on fire. There is no self to set on fire. What are you doing? What are you doing? So. It's important to realize there is no tradition of the self at all. There is no self. How can you have a tradition of the self if there's no self at all? It's ridiculous. So you cannot get stuck in a tradition. It's a living tradition. It's right now. Steve tried to hit me. Okay, it's right now. And the tradition is no tradition of the self at all. It doesn't exist. That's the tradition. It's not limited to ethnicity or a place in the world or anything. It's not limited to Vajrayana Buddhism, you know, tradition. Tradition is that there's no tradition at all. So, is Longchenpa trying to do a rescue mission for Tibetan Buddhists? He might. It crossed my mind more than once. Same with Jamie and Kenshi Choki Lodro. And I said, I'll help you out. You deserve it. You know, I mean, you've been super helpful. Tibetan's been super helpful. Super helpful. They gave us a big boost when we needed it. You know, so they, you know, time to pay them back, so to speak. Out of gratitude for that, and they need help. I'm seeing this, and this may be what Longchenpa is working on, actually. Partly is they need help from outside of their tradition. They need help from outside. Their tradition's imploding, and they realize it. Sure, you can keep the superficial accoutrement that Christianity has for a long time, but it imploded, you know. When it's gone, it's gone. It doesn't matter. You keep the empty rituals and the pomp and the ceremonies and everything. No. We've already been through that with Christianity. So I'm an expert on that. I know, you know. So we forged on without any tradition, without any culture. Okay. And this is what has to happen. So, would any of them listen to me? I don't know. None of them have yet. Yet. They might want to start doing so. Well, you are a great Rinpoche. You're either, no, I'm in, but I work for one. My Dharma prince, I work for one, Longchenpa. I work for Longchenpa. I'm not stuck there, you know. I want to help everyone, but I can see the trouble that Tibetans are facing. And they don't quite see it. Well, they see it, but they don't know what to do about it. Because their pride, you know, in their tradition, their confidence and pride, you know, doesn't allow them to. It's like Christians. So will Christians listen to anybody outside their tradition? No. Does anybody listen to it, to anything outside their tradition? Generally not. But I'm this super ecumenical capacity, willingness. And Jamyang Kenshi Chogyi Lodo is super ecumenical within Tibetan Buddhism. You know, he helped out vastly with that. It's a super bad problem there, sectarianism. So I absolutely can shift between any tradition, just nothing. It's like no problem whatsoever. But those stuck in traditions, they go down with the ship. A lot of Christians are going to go down with the ship. What is that? Did Jesus tell you to go down with the ship? I don't know where he said that. Well, it's not what he says. It's not his intention at all. You go down with the ship. What does that mean? You go down with the ship of your expectations that there's a self, a definable self. That your religion no longer helps you move past that, and so you're just going to accept that? What is that? Jesus didn't come to establish a religion. He came to liberate us from our false expectations that there's a definable self. There's no definable self. We're formless. How could freedom be defined? There's no definition that at all. The Tibetan Buddhists say, well, there's no way we can do it without the visualizations and all the rituals and all this, you know, stuff. That's not true. That's not true. That's just a way. And if they say there's no qualified teachers to teach us, we're doomed. This is nonsense. Just full stop in the wow. Just say, hey, we're not doomed at all. Wow. But I'm never going to be identified as some particular approach. I've always aimed beyond any approach in particular. That's a structure. It's a wall of expectations there too. You have to go. There is no self that these traditions are helping out at all. So we have to start becoming more ecumenical. Ecumenical. There is, well, on Facebook, there are some that are doing that, but well, not exactly. There's some that within Hinduism they're very ecumenical with Ramana, with, you know, with Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma, with these various Hindu teachers, but they never pay any attention to Jesus Christ at all. It's like, what? Or they never pay any attention to Longchenpa at all. Or Jamyang Kyentse Chokyi Lodo, or Chando Sering Chodron, or, you know, right? They're flexible within their tradition, but that's where their wall of expectations, they run up against that wall. But I'm not like that at all. I can, like a butterfly, I can go from A Course in Miracles to Ramaharshi to Nisargadatta Maharaj, to Longchenpa, to this, to that, to New Thought, to the Christian Science, whatever. And to me, it's all the same. It just helps our determinations, rally our determination, so we can go beyond the wall of our expectations, and then wow that, recover from that shock, and then summon more will and determination to push beyond our wall of expectations again. That's all that it all is. All traditions are just designed for just that. Same. It's bizarre, Facebook, the lack of interest in Jesus It's just bizarre. It's absolutely bizarre. I just have to say, wow, Jesus, this is just amazing. Lack of interest in Longchenpa is amazing. Yeah, Nyingma Master's website. I did a search on it, and there's a couple of mentions of Longchenpa. I think one quote. I said, what? One picture, one quote. What? He's the highest. You know, he's the apex, the very heart and soul of Nyingma Buddhism, really. The Nyingma Masters, he's the embodiment of all Nyingma Masters, actually. As Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro certainly has that same feel to it. As he, to me, I see the embodiment of all, the whole tradition is embodied in him. But they're more interested in marketing Buddhism. In marketing Tibetan Buddhism, so they have these more charismatic teachers who are more savvy with Westerners, and you know, let's spread. And so they like to highlight those who are, you know, but Longchenpa is not very marketable, so not really emphasized much. Well, guess what? Marketing is a losing game. Don't be a marketer. Be a realizer. Marketing has a role, but if that's overemphasized and that's just what you rest upon, you will fail. You will fail. You will still believe there's a self, and then the subject to all misfortune and ups and downs that you think this self. That the self, such a self would be subjected to. Yeah, when you have an imaginary self that doesn't exist, you got a problem of maintaining its existence, its hypothetical existence, don't you? And you have to avoid realization, don't you? Of course you do. And that's extremely difficult to avoid realization. So you will enmesh yourself in a massive dream of existence. And it will keep compounding and compounding and compounding. Of course you will have to do this. I didn't work out yesterday so much, but I actually did by working so much. I had to do some physical labor that I did really fast. It was amazing. I was in this race. There was this Hispanic, this, probably from south of Mexico area. And he was there right beside me. And he had some labor he had to do, similar labor. And I said, wow, this guy's a professional laborer, no question. You know, really strong. You can tell, rugged. And he's working fast. And I say, wow, I have actually much more to do than he does. But I said, I don't want to look like I'm some weak, what do they call me? Yankee or something. I don't know what they say. I don't know what they call it. They don't get into that, at least around me. Americano. I have some weak, you know, Americano. So I said, I better start working faster. And then gradually I started working faster, faster. And I said, hey, let me see if I can catch up with him. And, you know, he's ahead of me. So I start really working fast and hard. Wow. I was moving like lightning. And I went faster and faster and faster and faster and faster. So I was just like super bad. Poof, 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 poof. Super workout, actually, of overall body strength. Flexibility, lifting here, throwing this, throw everything. It taxed my entire fitness system. And you know what? I beat him by like 3 seconds. It was very close at the finish line, but I nipped him at the wire by 3 seconds. It was super intense, and I was like sweating. I was like, wow. So that was a workout in a way, but it showed me how fit I am. Is that I could do this and move. It was a combination of flexibility, power, and speed, and coordination, just everything. Tested everything, and I passed the test in flying colors. So I thank that man for being there, and actually was praying for some way to help, and this was the help that I got. It was just showing me that I can do it. I can do it. When I have to move fast, I can move very fast, and I'm very quick and nimble, actually, even though I feel so tired and achy right now, but I can summon the will to do it, and body will respond. So that was a and then lifting a lot of stuff, I did that. So I got, but it wasn't like a intense workout where I'm just maxing out everything till I'm so exhausted I can't move anymore. You lift the weights until like you just can't do a single one. That's it. Like, so you really, you know, pushed it. You can't do that every single day. I've been doing that pretty much every single day, but I said, let the body catch it. Let it recover now a little bit. So I don't know about today. We'll see. I don't know. Maybe. So be super determined. Be desperately determined. It's the best way to look at it. You are the undefinable isness, undefinable freedom. Not a self, but undefinable freedom. Be desperately determined to see that anything other than that has never existed at all. And there's not even a trace. And dreaming has not left any trace at all upon reality. It never has. Nothing's ever happened. Be determined to recognize and see that nothing has ever happened. No self has ever happened. No existence has ever arisen, actually. No creation has ever taken place. No destruction has ever taken place. No life has ever taken place. None of that has ever happened at all. And there's no trace that it's ever happened. Nothing. Lost a couple pounds. That's good. I gained like 5 pounds. And that was good. Now I need to drop down a little bit. I dropped 2 sizes, waist size actually. I just bought a pair of shorts, and I decided to go down to 2 sizes down. I don't know if I could fit. Well, they fit. They're snug, you know, just right. So drop 2 full sizes down. That's pretty good. So I want to keep that. I don't want to go back up. I want to stay light on my feet. But sometimes I just felt like I needed a little bit of heaviness in my system, and it was helpful. And other times you'll feel, let's go with the lightness. Lightness now. A couple things, a couple more areas to cover. When I was going through this intense recognition this morning, the ego tried to tempt me. He said, hey, you need to go work out. You know, okay, great. You're really fired up now that you're having so success. Put that into a workout. And I said, what do you mean? I have been working out every single day. I'm in great shape. I don't need to work out right now. So the ego was trying to say, oh, you're working out. It's great. You got to go work. It was using that as a way to lure me away from the wow, the workout. And this is what I've been warning everyone about. Holy Spirit's been warning me, I'm warning you, passing it on. There may be a fitness craze coming up, a dance craze, all this stuff. This is designed to get you away from the wow. It's an entrapment thing. So, but if you're already in great shape and already know how to work out and can put in a good workout and can do you're very dancey on your feet. I mean, I don't have to dance. I am dancey right now. I'm dancing, period. So I don't have to go into some dance mania. Like, remember, disco was a dance mania. These dance manias are designed to distract us from the spiritual path, actually. And these crazes, these workout stuff, fads come along, right? So I immediately said, no. I caught it right away. I said, I'm in great shape. I'll work out when it's time to work out. But right now, I can afford to spend a couple hours on the full stop on the wow. And I pushed the ego away. The ego was trying to get me to stop and says, you need to work out. I said, no. But if I was in terrible shape, you know what? The ego would have hooked me on that. You see? I said, oh, yeah. Yeah, I do. I need to get in shape better because that'll help me, strong. No. The ego has a hard time saying I'm not in shape, right? I mean, I proved to myself I am. I already proved it, which is really important. So if someone comes along and says, "Hey, everybody, let's go work out," I'll say, "Hey, everybody, let's just stay here for a couple hours and sit in the wow, and go through our desperate determination, bringing to light the truth. There is no self at all, no definable self at all, no existence at all. Let's go through that, and then calm down from the wow from that. It might take, half a day or something, okay? And when we're gone through that, then we can get back to do a workout. I can do a workout in a half an hour or less, actually. I know how to do it. It doesn't have to consume your day. You don't have to do it right now. And so if you're in great shape, do you have to work out right now if you're in great? Well, what's the point of working out if you have to work out right now? Isn't this saying, "Well, I'm in such terrible shape, I got to work out right now"? No. If you're in great shape, shouldn't you be able to enjoy the fruit of that? So it should not be obsessive. The ego wants to obsess about it. So ego always wants to get us into an obsessive fad of something where we avoid the spiritual path, the discipline. Always. So the Holy Spirit told me, "You better be in good shape coming up." I said, "Okay, something's coming up." I said, "Yeah, definitely." Or, "Yeah, really it is." And there could very well be dance crazes hitting the world. They keep coming along, but there could be some major cultural crazes coming along. In fact, I would say almost for sure there's going to be some major cultural crazes going on. And you might, if you're not in great shape, you're going to get swept up into them, or you're going to get swept up into opposing them, which is the same distraction, isn't it? So I try not to get swept up in it. Either I didn't get swept up in disco, and I didn't get swept up in opposing it. There's so many people got into opposing it, No, I just ignored it. I've just ignored all the fads and trends, basically. But the Holy Spirit has me do stuff ahead of time, so I'm already kind of hip to it all. And so when the craze comes, I'm just saying, "Eh, it's no big deal. I'm already hip. I'm hip enough." So you need to be really hip to avoid hipness, the fads of hipness, okay? And avoiding the fads of hipness is all important. You can't get caught up in that. And culturally, this is what happens now. Whereas, like in Tibet in the old days, they had this, wonderful dharma going on. That was their tradition. Well, we don't have a wonderful dharma going on in the world, folks. I don't care what anyone says. We have a terrible reptilian-brained, wall of expectations being built here. Entrapment to going on, and these fads are designed to sweep us away from the spiritual path. So we just have to be very hip, already very hip, and just so we can ignore them, and don't go with them, and don't go against them. Okay, it's really important. Don't go with them. Don't go against them. So Trump is a fad right now, sweeping the world. I'm not going with him. I'm not going against him. Catching on, it could be a worldwide fad, just like the POTUS was a worldwide fad, right? Swept a lot of people away. I didn't go with him. I didn't go against him much. I certainly pointed out to people, "Hey, don't go with him," because that the trend is so many people going with him. But I also pointed out to people who are going against him. I said, "No, don't get caught up in that. Be aware, of course, that he's certainly working for very much Antichrist, very much so, but." Just let it go at that. Say, "Okay, well, how does that stop me on my path?" Not at all, actually. Not at all. So be hip enough that you don't go with it or against it. And if there's a fitness craze coming up, be in good enough shape so you don't have to go with it or against it. And the yoga girl said, "Come on, grab your hand, come on, let's start dancing." And said, "No, not right now. I'm focusing, on my spiritual path at this point. I have to wow some insights I've been having here. It's absolutely essential." And if she looks at you and says, "Wow, you don't think you can dance?" Or, and if you feel that you're not dancing through life already, you're gonna feel embarrassed and shame, and they'll hook you. I know they're very good hookers, actually. Women are extremely good hookers. Very talented, skillful hookers. They hook on into all sorts of stuff. Dancing is one of them. But for me, I would just say, you know, hey, you know, what do you mean? Come on, let's dance. What do you mean? I am dancing. My whole life is a dance. I'm a super dancer. Why don't you start dancing the dance of wow? That's the ultimate dance. You know, you're like, whoa. So you just, you know, you walk right past it all. You don't get hooked into it, and you don't get hooked into trying to be against it, you know. So there's it's in our culture, world, global culture now, it's important, very important. The Holy Spirit is emphasized to have this hipness, okay, really, so you can avoid the hipness, the fad, the hip fads. And it's likely the world's just going to go completely insane very soon, this summer. And it'll explode in social media and people will lose their minds, you know, really. They say, oh my God, there's a way for me to be hip. You know, I got to do it, I got to do it, I got to do it. I got to be a graffiti artist on the wall of my expectations. Oh, here's a way to dance within the wall of my expectations. Okay, there's how we capped it. Now let's dance within this cappedness. The reptilians have capped it for us. Okay, now let's be happy and dance, dance, dance. Dance, 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 dance. Come on, dance, yeah. Woo, 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 woo. I didn't have a voice yesterday. It was gone. That's okay. I just harmonized, did what I could. It happens. Your voice can be there one day, it's gone the next. The wow tends to knock the voice out a bit. It can. What I did was, I did something really great. I said, okay, let me struggle. Don't struggle with it. Remember, don't struggle. If you're struggling, you're not listening to the Holy Spirit. You're listening to your own egoic belief in a self. So don't struggle. Catch yourself. If you're struggling, say, there's got to be a better way than struggling. Holy Spirit, help me. Holy Spirit said, put on George Jones instead of the Beach Boys. I've been wanting to, but I just didn't do it. So finally I did it. And I thought, I can't sing with him anymore because my voice has gone higher. Well, actually, I could sing fabulously with him. But I was able to harmonize with him, which I'd never done quite. I was doing it better than ever. And it was just like, wow, it's awesome. But he doesn't have the high parts, you know, so I was able to do all sorts of thirds and fifths and minors and stuff and play through his singing, using him as a root bass and then riffing off of that, you know, and it was just like, wow. It was like mind-blowing. It was just beautiful. I said, holy cow, that's singing, man. That is really... Singing is fun if you're really good at it. Even if you're not good at it, it's fun. But if you can just... Yeah, wow. It's very entertaining. We can entertain ourselves, actually. We don't need all this Hollywood, this entertainment industry. I don't pay attention to it at all. I can entertain myself better than they could possibly entertain me. All they can do is just this fear, reptilian stuff. That's all they do. They're a one-trick pony. It's all reptilian brain stuff, 100%. Even the spiritual stuff's reptilian brain. It's all it is. They've never made anything that isn't. I know there are people that want to watch this movie, it's very spiritual. No, it isn't. No, it isn't. It's not. I don't watch anything comes out of Hollywood or entertainment industry. Nothing that I don't pay attention to it. If the Holy Spirit has some reason, you know, like listen to the Beach Boys or something, well, I will do that. Get your work on your voice or whatever. I will do that, yeah. But otherwise, nothing. It's all reptilian. Reptilian brain, which makes us, again, worship, idolize those who are experts at the reptilian brain, the reptilians. You know, reptilian brain on steroids. We think, wow, this is really, let's party within the wall of our expectations. Come on, everybody. We got to, otherwise we're going to get totally depressed. So when we cap our awareness, this wall of expectations is there now. You can't go past it. You feel this terrible despair within you. It starts to arise. And then to fight back this terrible despair, you start partying like there's no tomorrow. And you start dancing and singing and partying and, you know, sex, drugs, rock and roll and fads and everything. You become frantic, desperate, because you've put a cap on your spiritual awareness that insists that there's a self that all this, that existence is happening to, that's educatable. There's no self. There's nothing to educate, and there's no existence at all. But when you cap it, then you get despair. And so we're ready, right now, we're ready in this July to cap our expectations in a very, very severe way, which is going to give rise to tremendous depression throughout the world, this tremendous despair, and people not recognizing what's going on, the inner dynamics, not knowing what to do, are going to turn to fads, or war. War is a fad too, actually. It's just another hip fad, war. That's all it is. Keep that in mind. Those who are fighting and warring and stuff, they think they're hipsters, that's all. This is how they feel. This is hip, really hip. It's just a fad. It's like disco. Really. So don't ever let someone trap you. Say, can you do it? Are you able to do that? Are you able to be like a front man? Don't ever put it in those terms. That's, when you feel the struggle and anxiety, Amelia traps you. You say, no, I'm already a front man. What are you talking about? Could you be as good a front man as Mike Love? I'm already as good as a front man as Mike Love. I'm already that. In fact, I'm even better. Well, we don't have to say better, but we say, I'm already that. I'm already that. There's no doubt about it. I'm already that. So there's no if. I'm right now. Could I do it? I am doing it. Don't ever say in the future, could I do it? Could I do that? You know, immediately you start feeling nervous and anxious. No. I'm doing it right now. I am doing it. I am doing exactly what I need to be doing right now. I am wowing the now right now, and I'm getting better and better at it. I'm already that. I'm already Longchenpa-ing, so to speak. I'm Longchenpa-ing. I'm already doing that. And I'll let him decide. He'll be the decision. No one else can judge. You know, don't let the world, isn't. Those who believe in a self are incapable of judging how good you are at it. So, is when the world asks you that question, it's those who believe in a self who are asking that question. They're really saying, how good are you at helping us believe in a self? That's what they're really asking you. Say, well, I'm really good at helping you not believe in a self. Yeah, but are you as good as such as well? You know, nobody here is capable of judging that one or the other, so I'll let the Dharma King judge that for me. I'm not concerned about judging myself. I'll let them judge it. I'm doing the best I can, and we'll leave it at that. Let the Holy Spirit judge it. So are you as, can you be as good as such and such? I'm doing the best I can, and we'll let the Holy Spirit be the judge of, can I do it as good as such and such or whatever. I don't need to even consider that one way or the other. Don't try to judge yourself. How effective, how far along I am. And it's up to the Holy Spirit to judge that, not me. I'm not really capable of judging that. Any belief in a self at all means you're not capable of judging yourself, your non-self, your lack of a self. Not capable of it. So don't do it. Just don't get caught up in that. Can I dance? Well, I'm dancing. I'm already dancing. Well, you're dancing really good. Well, it's up to the Holy Spirit. I have no idea whether it's good or not good. The Holy Spirit knows, though. So as long as The Holy Spirit, I know, I trust it. How could he do? Well, I trust it. I say, I trust it. You trust it? What do you mean? Trust? Yeah, I just trust it. Trust the Holy Spirit will continue to bring to my attention, help me with my determination so I can go beyond the wall of my expectations. So whatever the wall of my expectations are right now, I trust I can go beyond those. So it's not can you reach a certain point, it's can I go keep going beyond that point? Yes, absolutely. Can you be a good front man? Well, I can go beyond that, being a good front man, that wall of expectations, and even beyond that wall of expectations, you know? Don't allow yourself to be pinned down. Don't allow yourself to be pinned down, because then there's that wall. See, everybody wants to put up a wall so they feel comfortable with their complacency and their laziness, and their continuity fear is constantly advising them to put up that wall. Constantly. Now, we allow a temporary wall to form once we've gone past our wall of expectations, but we understand it's temporary. We don't fixate on it, because we'll push through that one also. It's just a temp wall. We're used to putting up temp walls and then tearing them down. Happens a lot. It's okay. You put up some interface with the world that seems normal to them, and then, but you know you're going to push past that one too. So don't fixate on it. Don't fixate on any sort of functionality. Say, I don't know. Could you be a good front man? I don't know. Only God knows that. Now, my cousin, I told you about my cousin. Well, they pulled the plug on her yesterday. Passed away. I don't know how, the particulars, details, etc. They said she's going to be a vegetable. Well, her directive was that she wanted to live a full, she wanted to be fully functional, living a full, complete, fulfilling life, or she didn't want to live at all. So what it was determined was that she probably wouldn't be able to live the life that she was living before the accident. So they, as per her directive, she was very clear about that apparently, as per her directives, they decided to pull the plug on her. I don't know how they pulled the plug, because she was breathing on her own and her organs are functioning fine. I don't know what they did, why she passed away so quickly, but she passed away very quickly. So did they administer some sort of drug, euthanizer? I don't know particulars, but not going to really pursue it at this point. It's, you know, what good is that going to do, except to realize that this is the culture we're in. I mean, come up with many, I mean, you know, for one thing, if you're in a wheelchair and you're not functioning great or something, guess what? You can use that to your advantage, because you can practice full stop on the WOW 24/7 and nobody has any expectations of you, not to. Oh, she's just sitting there like this, you know. Well, your mind could be practicing spiritual path intensely. So you could use it for it could be extremely helpful. Often accidents are very helpful. I've met people like that. Myself, I got so sick. All I could do was sit in the chair. So I used that to my advantage. Made lemonade out of the lemons. And so you often meet the people who've gone farthest on the path, have had some sort of affliction or trouble in their life, and they used it to their advantage. So I'm very much against assisted suicide. You know, just extremely against it. It's a very, very bad way to go in society. Again, it's the ego's way of trying to avoid the spiritual path at all costs, because, you know, there's sometimes you need to be crippled for a while. And Mario Mantisi, for instance, you know, is a perfect example. He was in a coma for a long time. He was blind, paralyzed, and mute for a long time, and he says the best thing that ever happened to him. He's a perfect example of using a crisis in a spiritual way. Mario Mantisi, T-E-S-E, M-A-N, I think, M-A-N-T-E-S-E. Or Montese, the bass player for Heatwave, you know, and so he was stabbed and you know, clinically dead, and went through all this, you know, near-death experiences and all this stuff. And he said, when I was mute, when I was paralyzed and blind, I turned within. My whole mind just completely turned within, and I was able to follow the light and see the inner light and follow it, and it became, it educated me about what real life is, it really is. And now he's a guru, you know? So this is a perfect example. Perfect example. And these people who are in a coma for a while, they have directives like, if I can't function the same way I did before, I don't want to live at all. This is very egoic approach, very, very much. You might come out of it better than ever. You might come out of it a saint. You might wake up a saint. Mario Mendisi woke up a saint from it. So a lot of people wake up from near-death experiences and their whole lives are changed. And they realize everything that they did before, being some perfect, you know, example of walled expectations, pleasing the ego, they might say, hey, I don't feel like I'm not attracted to that anymore. My life has changed. My purpose has changed. So many, many, many. So I don't like these advanced directives that say, you know, if I can't function exactly the same as before, I don't want to live at all. Pull the plug. And doctors are all now, everybody's like unbelievably solicitous about this. It's amazing. Before, there were major moral arguments about this, and the church stepped in and, no, don't pull the plug. You know, it was very difficult to pull the plug on anyone, as it should be, as it should be. Now, it's people that they're eager to pull the plug, as if this is hip. I gotta be part of the world that to come, you know. And so in order to be part of the world, yeah, assisted suicide, that's where it's at. In other words, maintain the wall of your prison at all costs. Don't wow anything at all. Just, well, isn't this just a reflection of their mental state? Is they pull the plug on any insight, anything, any determination and will and inspiration to go past the wall of expectations? Aren't they pulling the plug on that 24/7? They are. And then this reflects that they have no problem assisted suicide. They have no problem with it. California just passed it. Law. Governor signed it. The legislature passed it. I don't know if the people voted. I don't think the people voted. I think it was just a legislative thing. Unbelievable, huh? This is a sign of how terrible we've fallen. This is unthinkable. To spiritual traditions, and then they cremate the body immediately, which is crazy. Most spiritual traditions give like 9 days, 7 to 9 days. Tibetan Buddhists are, you know, very careful about that, because they do prayers, chants, flowers, incense, everything to help the spirit go into the, you know, the higher afterlife, highest afterlife experiencing, and ultimately try to stay with the light as much as possible. It's very, very helpful. And yet, you know, they pull the plug. They wisp into the crematorium, they get the ashes, and it's done. You know, efficient. Western efficiency. Modern efficiency. This is just lunacy, you know. It's just a way of again, short-circuiting your spiritual path. Pulling the plug on your spiritual path. People are pulling the plug on their spiritual path 24/7 in this world. And about 99% of the world is doing that. Pulling the plug on their spiritual path constantly. Euthanizing it constantly. We're in a constantly euthanized state. And what are we euthanizing? Our spiritual path. Plain and simple. Because we're believing in a self. We're trying to change reality. And our continuity fear is so scared about letting go of this, thinking, well, if I don't have a self, what am I? We're freedom. Freedom doesn't need any defined self at all. Oh, that's scary. So we're so scared of it. We keep euthanizing our path. And so we look like zombies, to tell you the truth. Well, that's why we're euthanizing our spiritual path. And those who haven't, they seem like different, you know, seem like kind of freak. I wore the shirt yesterday, the freak is back. Yeah, I was like a freak in the world, you know. Kids are like freaks, aren't they, to the older people. Hey, you haven't euthanized your path yet. What's the matter with you? Come on, we'll help you, don't worry. So step by step by step, they inject like spiritual, you know, drugs, euthanizing drugs into your, as beliefs, into your belief system. The belief system of the world is like a euthanizing action towards spiritual clarity, actually. So they euthanize your spiritual clarity here, is what they do. They absolutely do that. Now, in Tibetan Buddhism, in days gone by, there wasn't so much of that. There's, of course, there's still some, but there's a lot of prohibitions against that, right? So it was very helpful. So they didn't euthanize themselves so badly. Culturally, but now globally, we're all just euthanists. You know, the religion of the world is euthanasia. Actually, we're all practicing euthanists. That we are. If you talk to people, you realize they have no problem with it whatsoever. I don't even put my animals down. I don't euthanize the animals, and they They understand perfectly well. And they actually thank me. They say, I don't need to be put down. What are you talking about? I'm having these glorious experiences, actually. Actually, you talk to people who are going towards death, and they start having these very spiritual experiences. And they're really not focused on the body anymore at all. So sure, the body's suffering, but they're not paying any attention to suffering. It's just like sounds in your environment. Sure, but if you really focus on what we're doing here, like, I'm not even hearing the sounds. I'm not even paying attention to them. Very peripherally kind of thing. It's like that. When you're getting ready to drop the body, you're not focused on the body suffering. I remember my uncle, he just said, shh, be quiet. I said, I'm experiencing, and you see his eyes were just like, he was experiencing just something very profound and beautiful. So much, he was just getting old, but he was in like a trance state a lot of the time, and his eyes were just luminous. I just liked hanging out with him. We all did. I mean, I saw it. I said, wow, this is really amazing. He said, could you just be quiet for a while? I said, okay, thanks. But my banter is not meant to engage anyone. It's just a reassuring kind of thing. It actually helps let them know that there's somebody there functioning fine, so he can be in that state. And he just sit there quietly. And he never said what he was experiencing. But you could see in his eyes were like golden. It's like golden light in his eyes. He's gone on to some very high afterlife situations, no question about it. He was probably a Tibetan Buddhist in a previous life. A lama or something. Really, my uncle. He was just, his manners and his kindness and compassion were just absolutely extraordinary. Totally exemplary. And everyone notices, just this is just an exemplary person. Wow, what a character! And towards the end, and it was like he had these luminous experiences. So he probably, was I imagine like a Tibetan tulku or Rinpoche or lama of some sort or practitioner. He had this super refined sensibilities, and this constant gentleness. But super intelligent, photographic memory. He could tell you something from an encyclopedia read 50 years ago. You know, oh yeah, page such as a computer. His memory was like everything was stored there, and he had access to it. He must have had from a culture which memorizing. I mean, a lot of the Dharma was memorized for hundreds and hundreds of years. It was passed down through memory. A lot of the, there's the written tradition and there's the oral tradition. Okay, what is it? There's two different words. There's a sutra and there's another one. But it's so the written tradition and then the oral tradition, you remember everything. But there are many Tibetans who can read a book and they remember everything they read. This is my uncle. He remembered everything that he read, everything that all the knowledge came to him. He remembered when he read it. He had a perfect memory until he was really, really old. And then it was kind of funny. We would have fun with him and have a laugh, and he wasn't too thrilled about it. But I'd kind of ask him, "Do you remember what was the lineup of the 27 Yankees again? For the 45 or whatever." Oh yeah, so there was, okay. So just one moment. And you could tell the access wasn't quite there. And then he would really grind on it, just hold his hand up. I just wait. Okay, Tony Lazzari at second, Bill Dickey behind the plate, Babe Ruth, of course, out there in right field. And then the pitchers, and I can't quite remember the fifth pitcher. And then he said, that's very odd. So for him, it was like extremely weird that he couldn't remember. Extremely weird. Because remembering is all he's ever known. I mean, as far as his photographic memory, he always remembers. So for him to not remember was a bizarre experience for him. For us, it's like, normal, but for him, not at all. So he had to have come from a tradition, whether it's a Vedic tradition or a Tibetan tradition or some sort of Buddhist tradition, some sort of tradition where memorization of the Dharma, of the spiritual teaching, it was super important. And some of these, you know, Brahmins in Hinduism, for instance, they memorized volumes and volumes and volumes and volumes and volumes and volumes of books perfectly. And they would pass it down. This is what they did. They didn't. It was all memorized. They had it all in their mind perfectly. So a lot of our tradition in the past has been perfect memorization, actually. The brain is just used as a computer. It's just a computer, actually. Very sophisticated computer. And they just scan. They're just scanning. And it goes right into the brain hard disk. And it's all right there. So they just pull up the scan. When did I scan that book? Okay, let me pull that up. What page you want? And literally they're searching in their mind. And, oh, there's the page. And then they just literally are seeing what they scanned into their brain. They're literally, they just read it just in their mind's eye. They can actually see it. And they just, like that. So now we have computers that scan, so we don't use our brain at all in that way. And so most people have no memory at all. I mean, in that way. We'll just Google it. Okay, page. Okay, there it is. But these people, they had amazing memories. After death, you let time pass and allow the consciousness to detach from its identification, get used to its new situation, and you don't just whisk the body away and cremate it. That is barbaric. I mean, we live in a barbaric reptilian society to an extreme extent. We don't realize to what extent. Pull the plug, whisk them away, cremate them, that's gone. You know, what? Where are the time for the prayers? Where are the time for the prayers and all that? I will do that at the memorial. Yeah, but why don't people sit around, let the body rest in state, and sit around and pray and sing, chant beautiful mantras and beautiful hymns, all praise to the victors. You know, there should be these beautiful hymns and mantras we say, is where we evoke, you know, the Pure Lands. All praise to the Pure Lands, the beautiful Pure Lands, the beautiful Pure Lands. And give this intention and prayer to the consciousness to go to these Pure Lands. Now, ultimately, this consciousness itself is false, too. There is no conscious self at all. There's only the freedom. You cannot define it. There's no definable self at all. But the Pure Lands encourage this sort of realization. We're attracted to this determination. Help us in our desperate determination. So may you be desperately determined to accept the undefinable one self. May you continue to be desperately determined in the afterlife. So you give all these empowerments and encouragement to those who have dropped the body. They're still present. This is, you know, their consciousness is still present. Instead, we euthanize them in hospitals and then cremate them. This is, I mean, how far away is that from Nazi Germany? It's sort of a spin-off, isn't it, actually? We're sort of spiritual Nazis now, actually, tell you the truth. We have spiritual Nazism now. We're spiritual Nazis, the world. Admit it, you know? We're spiritual Nazis. And we all have a little bit of that in us. We're trying to purge it, you know, get free of it. Trying to get free of being spiritual Nazis, working in a weapons production facility, which is this planet. Which is this dream of existence, really. It's all that it is. Now, another one more issue. This issue of sadness. I think Space Allowance has brought this up in the comments. Sadness. Yeah. I had a glimpse of that yesterday. And I've had many glimpses throughout my life and seen that. But I wowed it, is all I did. So if you wow the sadness, You're feeling the wow now. You're not feeling the sadness. So don't, when you see something clearly, oh, I'm letting life escape. All life is going to escape from me, my hands. We're going to realize it never was. There never was any existence, nor any self experiencing any existence. So there never really was what we call life at all. And we say that's very sad or something. But so you see that, I can understand. But immediately, I said, okay, went into the wow of seeing this. So this is the answer to it, to this issue of sadness. Don't wallow in it at all. Don't try to figure anything out. Don't think about it. Don't put it into concepts or analysis. Put it straight into the now, into the wow, which takes us all straight into the now. The wow leads to the now. The wow leads to the now. So certainly, that's a reaction, egoic reaction that can arise. But don't do anything at all to stop it. Just sidestep it and go right into the wow. Say, that's great. I'm seeing that. Wonderful. Wonderful. It means I'm about ready to let life escape from my clutches. Let it go. Let it escape, as Nisargadatta Maharaj said. Maharaj says, let it escape. Let life escape. Go on. Do it. Let it. So, any sort of reaction like that sadness, go right to the wow. Go right straight to the wow. Trust it. Trust the wow. Trust it. It works. And no more sadness for me. Gone. Immediately. Nipped it in the bud. If people ask, well, what are you going to do with all this? What you're doing is so great. Oh, yeah, but what are you going to do? I'm going to trust it is all I'm going to do. I'm just going to trust it. And then hindsight will determine, you know, that'll write the story. If you want to write a story, you got to wait for hindsight. And people, you know, too willing to be reporters. Well, I've got a bunch of, a globe of reporters. Everybody's a reporter, you know. They think they're a Nazi reporter, a spiritual Nazi reporter. This is the character now of the world. We're spiritual Nazi reporters. So you want a story. I said, well, you know, no, just trust it. You'll have to wait. The story will only be written through hindsight. That's it. Only the Holy Spirit knows the story in foresight. We'll know it in hindsight. And in between, what do? Trust it. That's what we're called to do. Trust it. This is what people, we have problems. Obviously, we have such severe problems doing that because we've gone so reptilian. Then we got lured away by entertainment. What the Holy Spirit did with me, he says, you entertain yourself. Learn to sing, play guitars and instruments, but especially sing. Because you can do it anywhere. You don't need all these expensive instruments, lugging them around, setting up. I said, oh, no. The Holy Spirit said, there's way better to sing. You're just driving, put on a CD, sing, entertain yourself. If you're feeling like, not, you know, I need some entertainment. Or make graphics. I entertain myself visually through you know, these wonderful graphics and videos I make. They're just like, wow, it entertains me. So this reptilian entertainment industry has got us to the point where we don't trust it. We don't trust the Holy Spirit anymore. And when you don't trust the grace of God anymore, then you know you're really, the continuity fear's got you trapped. It really does. There's no way out except to start trusting it again. That's it. You have to start trusting. It starts with trust in the Holy Spirit, the whole path. My path started with trusting in the Holy Spirit or the grace of God or some higher power, whatever. There's something that knows how to free us from our misery. Trust it. Don't try to write the story. Just trust it. We'll write the story. Someone will write the story in hindsight, maybe. Whatever. What's more important is to trust it right now. So it's pretty shocking that our cousin died. It's but I'm just I just put it into context. I wow it. It's a big wow. Wow. Because it points out the underlying mentality and dynamics that are going on, really. There's no point to me to just wow it. Don't be for it, don't be against it. Very important. Again, when a fad arises, don't be for it, but don't be against it, because you're still caught up in it then if you're against it. Just keep wowing your own clarity that arises. Now, if I worked at some dance, I mean, took lessons, worked at, I'm sure I could dance it. Ultimately, I could get it. I'm fit enough to do it. So I don't have anything to prove. I don't feel like I have to prove anything. Not right now. I said, yeah, maybe I'll dance a little bit later. I never did dance disco. Never did that. No. I never did any dancing in my life, actually. So, well, I could if I wanted to. I know I could. I showed myself that occasionally. I could move if I want to. I don't know about break dancing, though. That's a different story. That's the hip hop break dancing, flying around on the floor like that. That's they're experts. They're kind of daredevil show off sort of thing. But carnival stuff. Pretty amazing what they've managed to do. I mean, that's talk about fitness. Wow. It's mostly young kids that are just like monkeys with their fitness. I mean, it's unbelievable what they can do there. It's amazing. They have fun with it. Okay, remember, it's July 2, 16 here, and troubles are on the way. They're gonna cap our expectations, our spiritual expectations. Are gonna cap them. They're already done massive capping on them. Massive capping, massive capping. Assisted suicide's a massive capping, is it not? Kind of leaves out God and the grace of the Holy Spirit, and the fact that you can use unfortunate circumstances to your greatly to your spiritual benefit. This is a time-honored tradition. We gave great support and care to people. Christianity's been very good at this. They should be applauded. They valued life all the way to the last breath. They always feel that there's something spiritual we can get out of every moment. So Christianity's that has a lot of great traditions, really, but it's the whole thing's imploding right now. It's all being capped. The bishops put out this notice saying we totally disagree with this assisted suicide. We'll vigorously oppose it. But come on, who are they kidding? They're not gonna. They've lost every battle they've been in so far. The Catholic bishops, they just, it's just a full implosion mode, full collapse mode, full collapse mode. Absolutely, we're in full collapse mode right now, and we're likely to feel that cappedness in July now, July 24th, end of July, from 24th through the 29th. There's a we'll go through this, phase of despair, probably. We're headed towards despair, and then we're vulnerable to fads at that point. So we have to be aware of this, very aware of it. We're going to go through a vulnerable period coming up. So I'm calling the gurus in, have to be successful at that to avoid the despair. And we're going to have despair, and so we're going to feel faddish in some direction. So we have to somehow dissipate this faddishness in some way. And it might help to have someone that looks really hip, who's aware of this spiritually. So I try to look hip now at this point. So people say, okay, at least I'm with someone that looks hip. So if we need to get with some fad, we can. And this could be very helpful, actually. Very helpful. And so spiritually, we don't want to go faddish. We don't want to go against it either. So we don't want to be trapped in either way. So if we have someone that looks kind of like they're very hip, say, well, I could go with the fad, but they're not really telling me to go with the fad, but they're not going to let me go against the fad either. So I kind of can stay consistent with my path. Very, very helpful. Very helpful. So I'm just dressing right now, and it's sort of a casual sport, California casual sport athlete sort of look of, you know, hip look sort of thing. But people can feel, oh, he looks like he's really hip. Okay, so maybe if I'm paying attention to what's being said, I won't get left behind, you know, because the despair won't get me, which is really what all these fads are about. It's going to get wild, folks. The protests, the riots, the marches, the fads. I mean, we're headed into the mouth of the beast coming up. So I bought some shoes. The Holy Spirit had me get these very interesting shoes. I'm wearing them right now. And he had me get half a size small. I said, why? It's too tight. He said, no. Well, I said, well, maybe if I wear thin socks. I wear thin socks. Well, they're okay now. Okay, that's better. I said, okay. They're breaking in now. But then the Holy Spirit said, how about just go bare, no socks? I said, what? Yeah. So I'm wearing them with no socks, and they fit great. You know, it's snug, but it's a good snug fit. But it's really cool. So I'm wearing shoes without socks, which I've never done before, really, because, of course, that can stink up the shoe. But I got some odor eaters. I could actually use odor eaters. Spray it in there and keep it smelling good. Yeah. And that's very hip look. It's a very hip look. With socks, it's kind of weird, but without socks, it's a very hip look. And again, a hip look is helpful right now. Very helpful for those who want to stay on the spiritual path so they don't get trapped in either the fad or the anti-fad. Okay? You cannot get trapped in either way. Either way will pull you down with the ship. It's like the Titanic, you know, if you're on there starting to sink and everyone's screaming, running around, and you're saying, no, don't run that way, run this way. Everybody's running a certain way, so no, you're running the wrong direction, you're crazy, why are you running that direction? You're still going down with the ship. You should be in the lifeboats. You should be in the lifeboat, on the side. What's on the ship, side of the ship? The lifeboats. Get on the side. Get off to the side. So there needs to be someone there, like a captain's in uniform, by the lifeboat, saying, "Everyone, come aboard, captains. Welcome you aboard. Welcome aboard. Get in the lifeboat." You say, "Okay, great. We're at least there's a captain in the lifeboat, and it's a nice little okay, you know, like that." Someone dressed like a captain, you know, would be very, very helpful to encourage you to get in the lifeboat. If everybody's panicking, you'd be afraid to get in the lifeboat. The captain's there, nice and orderly. Okay, you stand, you go there. Welcome aboard. I'm Captain So and So, and we'll have a welcome to the ship. Very seaworthy ship. You're gonna enjoy it. So you go over there, sit over there. You sit over there, and everyone's gonna then relax. No one's panicking. And then you get in the row away from the Titanic. You know, and it's all okay. And you pick up some people who are in the water swimming. You know, so some people did survive in lifeboats. Absolutely they did. But you need to have this reassurance from someone who appears, you know, is very hip and says, don't panic. This is at least my theory. This is what I'm looking at it as. Because I've certainly gone in this direction. Holy Spirit has had me go in this direction. I say, what are you doing? I should be grunge, you know. I've got to be anti this stuff. No. Neither for it nor against it. Don't be faddish nor the anti-fad. Neither the fad nor the anti-fad. This is how you get trapped. Very important here is again and again, I'm nagging you. Neither the fad nor the anti-fad. Neither the fad nor the anti-fad. Neither the fad nor the anti-fad fad. Neither the fad nor the anti-fad fad. I'm so hip, I don't need to be cool, nor do I need to be not cool. See, it's like super hipness. You need super hippies. I'm a super hippie now. I was a hippie before, now I'm a super hippie. Hippie wasn't good enough. Now I'm a super hippie. A super mega hippie. The freak is back. The super mega hippie is back. We don't need to be for it nor against it. We're super mega hip. Meaning we're hip to the fact there's no self. Never, and therefore no existence either. Never has been. Nothing's ever happened. Continuity fear is our only problem. Full stop on the wow. It's how we manage our success of going past our expectations. Holy Spirit of God is how we build up our determination and courage to go past our expectations. Full stop on the wow is how we manage that breakthrough. And then that's how we manage our success of you know, the shock of exceeding our expectations. And then we build it up, let the Holy Grace of God build up more. So we're hip to that. So we're super mega hip.